Estero de San Miguel, Pasig River, and Quezon Boulevard. It consists of 80 hectares of asphalt and concrete jungle. It is intersected by some 45 streets and two esteros, on which once floated the Quiapo, a cabbage-like duckweed that gave the district its name. As the mercantile heartland of the masses, it offers the best buys. But Quiapo is rich in culture and history. Since the time Governor General Santiago de Vera declared Quiapo a separate parish in 1586, it has metamorphosed into a place distinct as well as diverse, while retaining traces of its glorious past. This week, Travel Time invites you to walk the streets of Quiapo and discover the mystique that gives it character and vibrancy.
Hong Kong trips for two, pocket money, three townhouses. Get the chance to win it all, tax paid in 7 monthly draws in Far East Bank's Yes to Million.
Yes!
Be a depositor now.
Quiapo is well known for the religious, almost fanatical piety of a large part of its population. Nowhere is this more evident than in the streams of people that visit Quiapo Church daily and the hordes that join in the celebration of the Feast of the Black Nazarene. Located next to Plaza Miranda, along Quezon Boulevard, is the Quiapo Church, the district's principal landmark. Standing on the foundations of three previously leveled edifices, each in its time by earthquake, fire, and the ravage of time, it is presently surrounded by sidewalk vendors peddling herbs, elixirs, and religious paraphernalia. The church houses a statue that is very dear to the hearts of Quiapo's many devotees. Kneeling on a platform with a huge cross on its shoulder, the life-size Christ is formally known as Nuestro Padre Señor Jesús de Nazareno, or simply, Señor. Devotion to the darkwood image of Christ rises to a climactic perch every January 9, when Quiapo holds its annual festival procession. Statue of the Black Nazarene sails forth in a surging sea of barefoot humanity, frenzied devotees who have deep-seated faith in the healing powers of the statue.
Bakit po kayo nakayapak?
Ito ay naging tradisyon na mula nung dali ng mga Meksikano rito imahin ng ating Nuestra Pong Jesus Nazareno. At siguro, isa rason para huwag magkasakitan.
Ano ho ang inyong panata?
Well, yung iba natupad na, yung iba wini-wish ko. Karamihan Thanksgiving na dahil natupad na good health, peace of mind, saka mapalaki yung mga bata, maayos na buhay. Ganun lang, simple lang.
Male devotees afflicted with an ailment or a soul-searing problem believe a cure or solution is forthcoming if they but join the hordes who take turns pulling the carriage of the Black Christ during the procession. The legions who have made a panata, a vow, to serve the Lord in this manner.
Ano ho inyong panata?
Ang panata ko ganito upang ang mga anak ko mapunta sa mabuting kawaraanan. Huwag malagay sa hindi magandang kalalagyan.
Para dyan ho, taon-taon nagpupunta kayo dito sa...
Taon-taon. Ay, meron ako mga 30 taon na namamanata.
Dito ho sa Quiapo.
Barefoot by devotional fiat, they surge to the last man toward the Christ carriage for a chance to push or pull it along its tortuous route, clamber over it to kiss the foot of the image or the hem of its robe, or simply lay a fervent hand on it. The devotion to the Nazarene, undisputed Lord of Quiapo, patron and refuge of the populace, the focal point of the district that since the early 1930s has been the heart of downtown Manila. Memories of old Quiapo right after these words from our friends.
This looks like a good place to stop.
Genteel past of Quiapo has left its mark in the proud-sounding names of its streets and the once elegant houses of its old families. These families were proponents of a generous urbanity that was soon legend. They created an ambiance of noble hospitality that emanated from large, luxurious houses along wide, straight streets lined with trees and cool promenades along the banks of the canals in the vicinity. Ere Hidalgo Street was formerly Calle San Sebastian, the 19th century's most prominent and fashionable strip. It was renamed in 1913 to Ere Hidalgo, after the famous painter who had died earlier that year in Barcelona. The Ocampo House in Ere Hidalgo was home to Francisco Santiago, the composer, who married Don Pablo Ocampos and Don Juana's eldest daughter, Concepcion. It was in that home that Santiago, father of nationalistic music, held the first concierto. The house later became the first conservatory of music of the Philippines. At the corner of Ere Hidalgo and Barbosa Street is the Nakpil Mansion. Once the home of patriots Julio Nakpil and Gregoria de Jesus, it became the favorite place of women of a gracious lifestyle. A long line of jewelers, the Nakpils ran a plateria, creating beautiful pieces of jewelry. These were displayed in cases in a room on the second floor.
Kasi po noon, gumagawa po sila ng mga alahas. Noted po ang mga Nakpil noon sa mga alahas. Marami pong
nagpapagawa
na mayayaman.
Lumaki ka dito sa bahay na to?
Opo.
Paano relative ka ng mga Nakpil?
Hindi po.
Ano?
Kasi po, ang grandmother ko, naging kusinera po nila.
I see.
Opo, lumaki na po ako dito. Parang
parang
naging kamag-anak na rin po ako.
Ano ka ngayon dito?
Eh, kami po ang naiwanan dito para naman po mag-alaga sa bahay. Parang katiwala po, ganun po.
Anong itsura ng bahay noon?
Noon pong panahon na yon, nung nandito pa po ang mga Nakpil na nakatira, magandang-maganda po ang bahay, maliwalas. Marami pong mga kasangkapan, bawat sulok po. Marami pong mga antigong kasangkapan.
Ay, mga painting?
Ay, marami po silang painting.
Ano mga painting nila?
Dito po sa Mihagda, na natatandaan ko po, may dalawang malalaking painting ni Juan Luna, tsaka po si Hidalgo. Meron po. Doon po sa Salas, marami rin po mga painting.
Lagi ba sila may bisita dito noon?
Opo. Lagi pong meron mga okasyon. Pagka po may kasayahan, punong-puno ng tao ang bahay. Nakalabas po lahat ang magagandang kasangkapan.
At saka siguro
ang magagandang kurtina, nakalabas po lahat.
At saka kaya po noon po, siguro puno pa ng mga halaman, ng mga trees.
Ay, opo.
Wala
pa
mga buildings, ano?
Opo. Marami po silang mga antigong halaman sa likod ng bahay. Actually po, ito pong asutea, meron pong climbing plants po dyan.
May hanap buhay ka rin dito?
Ay, opo. Dito na po ako nakapag-asawa. Kasi po katapat namin ng shop ni Maximo Vicente. Isa po sa mga sculptor nila na pang-asawa ko.
I see.
Apo, nung binento yung bahay nila, lipat po kami dito at nagkaroon po kami ng maliit na shop.
So ang asawa mo gumagawa ng mga
santo? Santo po, opo.
At nagre-repair?
Opo.
Today, the first floor of the mansion is a restaurant. Although its interior has been slightly transformed into a contemporary dining room, one can still see the floors of Piedrachina, remnants of the old architecture. The second story is the more faithful to the past, maintained by the nuns who live there and the caretaker, Selly Maglaki. If Ere Hidalgo was the site of the country's first conservatory and the district's foremost jewelers, Arlega Street fronted the homes of several renowned sculptors, among them Isabelo Tampinco and his son Vidal. Located next to their relatives, the Twasons, their home is about 120 years old and has survived the many calamities, wars, and events that claimed other less fortunate structures. And in it are preserved the sculptures and furniture which now belong to the children of Vidal Tampinco and his Pampangueña wife, Juana Zita. Fortunate is the old home of Felix Resurrecion Hidalgo. Standing at the corner of Tanduay and Bilibid Viejo, it once was a repository of treasures from another age. Now, all that remains is a skeletal structure stripped not only of the beautiful things that once filled its interior, but of every bit of wealth as well. The floor on which people walked and danced exists no more. Stripped off by scavengers, the remaining wood left to rot. The only traces of noble beauty left are panels of wood on which are carved designs of butterflies and mural-like painted ceilings. The exterior facade serves only to hide the rubble and the emptiness of what once was a historical monument. Most of the old families have left. Doña Nena Ocampo has remained in the house where she has stayed since she married the late Jose Ocampo. Having survived the ravages of time, their home is perhaps one of the best preserved old homes in Quiapo. Built in, possessing an entresuelo, an azotea, and other distinctive architectural features. Its walls are made of the best hardwood, and it still retains some of the old furniture, artworks, and paraphernalia of the late master of the house. Is venue to the family's weekend and holiday reunions. The property was originally used by Jose Ocampo's grandfather, Crisanto de los Reyes, for the purpose of growing ilang-ilang trees. Crisanto was a man of many business interests. Involved with the galleon trade, he exported the refined oils of the ilang-ilang to France as base for perfumes. In one of the property's corners, Crisanto managed and supervised his business in a shack-like office. It was the only structure in the plantation, and it was where Jose's grandfather found solace and peace of mind. After Crisanto's death, his daughter Scholastica inherited the property and with her husband, Mariano Ocampo, built what to this day stands along Mendoza Street. By the time the house was completed, Jose was about 2 years old. He grew up, raised his entire family, and passed away in it.
Tina, ano itsura ng Quiapo nung bata ka pa?
Well, it was a very nice place to live in. Uh-huh. Everybody knew everybody, uh-huh, especially around here. Uh-huh. No, it was clean and just, I think, beautiful for me at that time.
Uh-huh. Huh? Sino, who were the ones who lived here?
Well, like the Ocampos, the Paternos, the all the Arnetas were here, uh-huh, the Legardas, the Prietos. Uh-huh. No? So, I mean, when everybody would meet on Sundays in church.
What church did they go to?
San Sebastian, uh-huh, you know, because we were all around the church. Uh-huh. It was a very nice place. It was just one big family.
What were the residential areas?
Well, Aridalgo was very residential, and part of San Rafael also, mm-hmm, no, in Tanduay, mm-hmm, no, in Mendoza also, and Bilibid Viejo.
Mm-hmm. And it had many trees, I mean, maraming lumang bahay pa siguro.
No? Yeah, it was nice, and especially like in around the church, there was no school yet, uh-huh, no, so they had the garden. Uh-huh. It was really beautiful, a lot of trees.
And was there a lot of social life?
Not much social life, I suppose, uh-huh, maybe families, no, uh-huh, but not really much social life at that time.
And did you have any church activities?
Well, no, because the church was a private church at the, uh-huh, time, uh-huh, because we only became a parish in the 75, uh-huh, no, and before that, if people wanted to get married in San Sebastian, they had to have special permission. Uh-huh. And I recall there were not too many. I think after there were only about two or three marriages.
So it was really a church for the priests and for the residents?
Yes.
When did it start to change?
Well, I think in the 60s.
What happened?
Well, they had jeepneys, and I don't know, people started coming around here. I think they put more schools around here. Uh-huh. So with the schools came the boarding houses and the people from the provinces. Uh-huh. Because at that time, people knew everybody. Uh-huh. No, even in the callejones, people knew people. Uh-huh. Huh? And if there was any trouble, everybody would come out. Parang talaga man, big family pa. Mm-hmm. But not like now. You don't know who's next door. And
When did the families move out?
About 50s or 60s.
Mga 60s. Uh-uh. Why do you insist on living here?
Well, I was born here. Uh-huh. I grew up here. And I love this place.
Historic landmarks in historic Quiapo, right after these reminders.
This is GMA, the largest, the most powerful, the best. Now joining the ranks of the world's finest. Where you belong.
This is what an ordinary afternoon looks like in Batanes. There's no tropical depression, and yet the seas are so rough, they could be threatening. Join us for a one-hour special report on Batanes, a battered bastion.
Back to the multi-awarded travel time.
What makes Quiapo so interesting is the harmonious diversity of its people and the institutions that have thrived there throughout its history. Standing right in the heart of Quiapo is that magnificent temple of Gothic art, San Sebastian Church. It holds an enviable and enduring place in the history of art and engineering feats. It was the first all-iron church in the whole world. It was also the first iron edifice in Asia and the second in the world after the Eiffel Tower in Paris. The prefabricated iron structure, indeed, is sui generis in Asia. Unknown to many, the stability of the church is perfect as a result of the foundation. The center of gravity of the edifice is way down below its massive concrete foundation, making it harmlessly sway with and withstand intense seismic movements and typhoons. Its polychromatic glass artwork can compete with those of the Gothic cathedrals of France. The Gothic architectural style displays its slender spires pointed heavenward in unwavering defiance against the elements and in loving memory of its predecessors, all worthy houses of God. In 1973, San Sebastian Church was declared a National Historical Shrine. The first structure of the church and convent was built in 1621 in what was then called Barrio Kalumpang, named after the trees that were common in the area. Its founder, Father Rodrigo de San Miguel, vice provincial of the Augustinian Recollects in the Philippines, decided on the location for two reasons. It was an ideal place for repose and spiritual retreat for the missionaries, and he felt that the populace of Kalumpang, then numbering 300, needed spiritual direction. The church and convent were named after the glorious Roman martyr, San Sebastian, to whom Father Rodrigo was staunchly devoted.
What was it like around San Sebastian in the old days, and what was the church like?
Well, the church was, it was a private church of the Augustinian Recollects. It was open to people, but kind of old and musty looking, you know, not like now that it's really bright and people want to come in. Now, the surrounding areas, well, we were like a family because we knew each other, you know, around San Sebastian, we knew each other.
Was there a lot of activity in the church?
Well, not much. Just, you know, the regular masses and all that. Because even weddings were not really allowed here except by special permission.
I see. And how about mga processions and fiestas?
Yeah, we had the procession. Our procession was January. It was January 29. And they had the Caballeros del Carmen and the Damas del Carmen, you know. And it was very well attended by the religious at that time.
What's happening to the church this year?
Well, this year we are celebrating the centennial of San Sebastian Church. And also, this is August 15 to 18. And also, we will have the canonical coronation of Our Lady of Carmel on August 18. We will have a procession and then the coronation probably outside, weather permitting. By the cardinal and the papal nuncio, then we will have the mass.
It's a big festivity.
Oh, very big. And that's why we would like to take this opportunity to call all the old families from here, because we will be having a reunion of the Familias Antiguas de San Sebastian. That is on August 15.
And what will happen on August 15? What activity will there be?
That is the first day of the Triduum.
Okay.
We have a Triduum, and we would like them to sponsor the mass. And after the mass, we would like them to renew old friendships and probably help us a little. And we will have cocktails after the mass for the old families.
And renew their affection for the church.
Yes. Because we chose that day because it is the Feast of the Assumption. And also on that day, we are also having the lighting ceremonies.
Lighting?
By the PTA, Philippine Tourism Authority.
What do you mean lighting ceremonies?
We are installing lighting, interior
inside
lighting
the church.
For the church, yes. To highlight the paintings and the dome and the ceilings.
Then it will become a real tourist attraction.
That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to attract tourists here to this area. Because when they go to Malacanang, they can pass San Sebastian.
Yes. And hopefully after this, the rest of Quiapo.
Hopefully.
The residential
because
area.
Yes, we do love Quiapo.
The church is also known as Iglesia de Nuestra Señora del Carmen because of the enshrinement in the newly built church of the statue of the Virgen del Carmen in May 5, 1521. The church was the first Philippine shrine of the Lady of Mount Carmel and the only one for the next 200 years. In 1621, the primitive church was set aflame during an uprising of Manila's Sangli population. The second church that was built by the Recoletos after it was torched was in 1645, destroyed by a violent earthquake. Although the third structure survived the British occupation troops in the 18th century, it was damaged by another quake in 1859. Soon after, the church underwent substantial repairs, only to collapse once more in yet another seismic calamity in June 1863. It was torn down and rebuilt to face another series of earthquakes and aftershocks that leveled it to the ground. Through all of these calamities, the statue of the Virgen del Carmen survived. By 1890, the patient and persevering Recoletos, determined to build a catastrophe-proof edifice, went to Genaro Palacios, a famous architect, with the plans for a new church. It would be built entirely of steel. In June 1883, Palacios presented the blueprints, and in March 1886, the contract was awarded to the Société Anonyme d'Entreprise de Travaux Publics, a Belgian firm. It took 8 ships carrying 50,000 tons of iron steel and glass artworks to ensure the completion of the 4-year project. The building commenced on May of 1887 and was completed on the July of 1891. Another structure of formidable strength in the heart of Manila is the Chinese Pagoda. Although younger than its neighbor, San Sebastian Church, its history is just as interesting. At present, it stands a battered sentinel, witness to a short but eventful 50 years. It is stripped of the objects of art, sculptures, and paintings that once decorated its interior. Garden where deer and peacocks once roamed, and which used to be full of artistic structures, is now lined with shanties, huts, and tenements. The pagoda and its garden was designed by the owner himself, Jose Ocampo, and they were built within the perimeter of his compound. Oblivious to what people said, he acted on his caprice to build a structure that would combine Japanese, Chinese, and European art and architecture. He commissioned Don Maximo Paterno, a prominent engineer, and several Japanese overseers. However, he argued with them constantly on ideas of beauty, and of course he would have the final say, being the employer. He followed neither rule nor norms in the building of the edifice. He would always insist on the best and strongest materials,